Good morning, Bethany. Welcome to the first Sunday in March, and it's also the first Sunday of Lent. March is that warming and wet month, but let us brighten our hearts with Crown Him with Many Crowns. Please stand and sing with me. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. Come, now is the time to worship.
The time to worship. Now is the time.
come. Now is the time to worship. Come. Now is the time to give your heart. Come. Just as you are to worship. Come. Just as you are before your God. Come. Willingly we choose to surrender our lives. Willingly our knees we bow. With all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, we gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to just as you are to worship. Just as you are to kneel your God. Mighty to save. Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior. Take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. more song to do. I was off. I Will Rise is what we're going to sing now.
That's the closing.
Oh, that's the closing. I thought so.
Yeah. Sorry.
You may be seated. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for being here today at Bethany. And sometimes we do like to do songs twice, but not normally. So we'll save that one for the end. But it is good to see each and every one of you here this morning. God bless you. And thank you for choosing to be at Bethany this morning to look to the Lord. If you're here in person, we hope that you were greeted warmly, that you received a program on the way in, and that you'll find in there all the information you need to worship this morning and to be aware of the things going on throughout the week. If you're joining us online this morning, thank you so much for allowing Bethany to be a part of your Sunday morning and to come into your home. You're going to notice as we stream this morning, there is a link in the comments that go by, and that is a way for you to access the program and all of that same information. And we hope that you will take a moment and leave a note there in the comments. Let us know where you're watching from this morning, particularly if you're a first-time streamer with us. Want to draw your attention to a couple of things this morning. First, if you signed up for the marriage night, that's this Saturday, 6:30 to 8:30 up at the chapel in Winchendon. Don't forget about that. We will see you there. If you haven't and you still want to, I think there were like 6 spots left. And so it's basically full. So if you would like to join us on Saturday evening for a time of just encouragement for your marriage, just enjoying fellowship with other believers, just a good time of refreshments and teaching, want to encourage you to hop on that and do that quickly. You're going to notice out in the commons this morning, there is a new basket out there that has a sign that says Gardner CAC. And we are during the weeks of Lent collecting non-perishable food items for the CAC. And you can bring those any Sunday and leave them there. And they are a blessing to the people in our community through that program. Want you to know Julie Meehan, who is the director and works there on a regular basis, works with me as I'm part of the board. Will be with us on the 20th, and she's going to share a little bit about how that works in the community and how the community is impacted and ways that we can continue to be involved in the community. Julie's a great lady, attends down at Chair City Church, and looking forward to having her as a part of our time together on the 20th. Want to have you aware of a couple of special next step opportunities. Next week, so that is Sunday the 13th, is the Bethany information class. Maybe you've been attending Bethany for a while. You want to know more about how Bethany works. Maybe you're interested in becoming a member. It's kind of a first step in that. And love to have you join us for the Next Step Hour following the service next week. Attending that doesn't require you or obligate you to be a member, but it's just a way for you to ask us questions and for us to get important information to you. And so that is the 13th. On the 20th, we started advertising. There is going to be a missions lunch. There are no Next Step groups that Sunday. And we're going to have Rosie with us, and Rosie is going to share about her experience in Honduras back in, I guess it was December. And so, December, right? And so, hope that you'll come for that. There's a sign up out in the commons. The mission board is asking you to bring either a dessert or a salad item to go along with the food that they're going to provide. And so, so join us for that if you would. Sign up, RSVP is important. And then the 27th, it's a busy month. 27th, during the Next Step hour, we're going to be doing a special Next Step group on the issue of baptism. Some of you may have already, you followed the Lord in baptism, but we want to take the opportunity to offer baptism as an issue of obedience and as an issue of praise and worship to our Lord for how he transforms our lives and gives us the opportunity to share that with people. So March the 27th is that class, and we hope that you'll join us for that. There are a number of other things going on. We're going to let you be aware of those through the calendar Be aware of those things that are happening through information out in the commons. So with that, I'm going to invite Randy Heimla, who is our deacon of the day. He's going to come up and share some prayer updates, which many of which we shared on Friday through email, and lead us in prayer this morning. And then following that, Penny Hebert is going to come and lead us in scripture reading. Randy?
Good morning. So some prayers that were already highlighted in email, I will reiterate in case you haven't heard them. Jerry Spencer had successful knee surgery yesterday. I'm guessing yesterday was, based on the day, okay. So at some point, she had successful knee surgery. So we hope for, we pray for a quick recovery. Julie Ciano, Jim Power's mother, had successful carotid artery surgery. And so we want to pray for a quick recovery for her. Kevin, a friend of the Powers family, is home from the hospital after COVID complications. We want to pray for strength during his recovery. We want to pray for Mike Catano, who's having back surgery, or had back surgery, maybe. He's a friend of the Westburys. Jeremy Brown is back in the hospital with continued struggles with pneumonia. The doctors are also concerned about long-term neurological damage. We want to pray for Judy Durkee Stone, who tested positive for COVID this past weekend, must have been last weekend. She's resting at home, so we want to pray for her healing. We want to pray for Pat Westbury as she anticipates cortisone injection Wednesday. And pray for Jillian, Jody's cousin, who's struggling with mental illness. Also, a prayer request that came to me from Joe Westbury. Consuela Hernandez is in the hospital, very ill. And another prayer from Joe that Lupe Mendoza, Pat's niece, has cancer throughout her body. So if you follow me as we approach the Lord in prayer. Father, we approach your throne of grace. It's through the death of Christ that you tore the veil that separated us from you. And now we are free to come into your presence, and you encourage us to do so. We thank you, Lord, for all that you provide for us. And we thank you for the successful surgeries that people have had. We thank you, Lord, for the success with Jerry Spencer and Julie Ciano. We pray you would help them to get through their respective surgeries, that you would heal them. We thank you that Kevin is home from the hospital, and we ask that you would help him to heal from his illness. We lift up Jeremy Brown and his family. We pray that you would help Jeremy heal from the pneumonia. And we don't know what the long-term effects are. You do, in your omniscience. And we pray, Lord, that your healing hand would be on him. We also pray for Jeremy's family. We don't know the spiritual condition of them in their hearts. We don't know if they're against you or for you, but Lord, we pray that you would help them to seek you in this time, always to seek you. Help them, Father, to see your amazing power on display in Jeremy's life. And help them to have a desire to follow you. We lift up Judy Durkee Stone as she's recovering from COVID. We ask that you would heal her and be with Marty as well as he cares for her. And we pray, Lord, that you would help them to keep their focus on you, knowing that spiritual condition is so much more important than a physical condition. We pray, Lord, that you would help Pat Westbury. Help her with her back pain, the whole reason why she's having this cortisone shot. We pray that you'd heal her back and help her, Father God, to get through this. We lift up Consuela Hernandez and the illness that she's facing. We know, Lord, that you can heal her, and we pray that you would do that. We also lift up Lupe Mendoza. We know that nothing is beyond your power to heal. We pray, Lord, that if it's your will, that you would circumvent the laws of nature and remove this cancer from her. Above all, we pray for the spiritual well-being of Lupe and Consuela, that you would help them to follow you, to desire you, give them your peace at this time. We also ask that you would be with Jillian, Jody's cousin, who's struggling with mental illness. Father, we know that the most important kind of healing is spiritual one, so we would start with that and ask that you would help her spiritually to be in a right relationship with you. And we pray, Lord, that you would help her mentally with this difficult time that she's facing. We ask, God, that you would work in her life and the life of her family, that you would help them to seek you. We commit her to you now. Father, so often we know life is full of pain, and pain reveals genuine faith. And with a genuine faith, you can use us greatly. Lord, we pray that we would value you in our lives. We'd value what you value. We would go in the way that you want us to go. We declare to you now our love to you, Lord, our desire to be right with you, and we realize that we are nothing apart from you. You are everything, and we pray, Lord, that you would help us to live our lives knowing that you are everything and that you are in total control. We pray, Lord, that you would be with our church, helping us to proclaim your gospel to those that don't know you. Pray, Father, that we would elevate you to those around us and honor you so that they may see what we see, and that is a loving God who wants the best for us. We pray, Lord God, your blessing on our service now. We pray you be with us and help us to hear your word as you want us to. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Good morning. It's my pleasure to read God's word to you today. We're reading from John 12, 1 through 11. Then 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, who had been dead, whom he had raised from the dead. There they made him a supper, and Martha served, but Lazarus was one of those who sat at the table with him. Then Mary took a pound of very costly oil of spikenard, anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the oil. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, who would betray him, said, "Why was this fragrance oil not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the money box, and he used that to take what was put into it. But Jesus said, "Let her alone. She has kept this for the day of my burial. For the poor you have with you always, but me you do not have always." Now a great many of the Jews knew that he was there, and they came, not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might also see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. But the chief priests plotted to put Lazarus to death also, because on account of him many of the Jews went away and believed in Jesus.
Thanks, Randy. Thank you, Penny. Let me invite you to take out your message guides this morning, and we're going to be looking at John chapter 12, and the message guide is a tool for you to use to track with the message, and the things that we're sharing allows you to reflect back later in the week, and provides a little study on the back of it for you to take our time together the next step. And if you didn't know, as if we hadn't already said, following the service, the next step group, one of them is a sermon discussion group for you to kind of work through those questions and have a little discussion with regard to how do we and how can we make this a little more practical. We mentioned this is the first Sunday of Lent, And this last week, and we mentioned the Right Now Media study that we are encouraging you to participate in, called the Lent Experience. For some of you, Lent is a regular part, perhaps, of your year, and you use that time to prepare for Easter. But for some of you, Lent may be a new thing, and we were encouraging and are encouraging you to participate. And so it's not too late, simply because today is the first Sunday. And the Lent Experience is just a 5 to 7 minute video once a week that gives you an experience for you to have during the week that helps you bring Lent and what it is into focus, helps you prepare for Easter and the events of Easter. There is a journal that goes with it called the Lent Experience Journal. I can give that information to you. The journals are $5. That just goes to cover the cost of for the people who have prepared it. And if you've ever wondered, well, why is Lent when it is, and why is Easter change every year? Why is it not the same like Christmas? If you've ever wondered what the liturgical calendar is like and how all of these things fit together, this is really a very interesting historical and spiritual study for you. And again, we want to encourage you to do that. And so we are going to just have that as a side experience, as well as our opportunities to meet together on Sunday mornings. So, as we have been working over the last number of weeks, we are in a study in the book of John called Life, and each week we are focusing on a different chapter or portion of a chapter, and doing it from the perspective of the theme, life. More than 40 times, John in this gospel mentions the issue of life, and very often, at each chapter, it is connected back to Jesus as the one who provides life. We saw that he is the power of life, the source of life. He is gives us the process of life. So we've just been working our way through. We've seen individuals refuse the life that Jesus offers them. And so we are now at Lent. And so we're kind of jumping ahead in our study in the book of John to the things that focus on and surround the week of Jesus coming to Jerusalem, Palm Sunday, the things of Good Friday, of the upper room on that Thursday evening, and then finally the burial and the resurrection of Jesus on Easter Sunday. And so so you're going to see all of a sudden we were at chapter 5, I guess it is, and then now we're at chapter 12. Fear not, we will come back to chapter 6 and work through that to chapter 11. But for right now, we are in chapter 12. You know, the last days are always very interesting. The last days of individuals. There are many books that have been written about the last days of the life of this person, or the last days of the life of that person. And in retrospect, we discover a lot about a person based on the events and the experiences, the things that they share, what they say, and the things that they do during those last days. And so we're going to find out a lot about Jesus as we look at these last day experiences and the things that he shared during that time. And so we're doing that by looking at chapter 12 and beginning there in chapter 12. Nearly one half of the book of John is given to this last week of Jesus' life and the things that happen after his resurrection. And so it's very interesting to understand that. If you look at the other gospels that are there, in that same, a large portion of everything that we know about Jesus focuses on this particular period of time in his life and ministry. And so that being the case, I would venture to say this is really important stuff. Because God in his providence has focused on this for our learning and for our encouragement and for our well-being. So as we look at the book of John, beginning in verse 12, we really kind of pick up beginning in chapter 12 on this last week. And in this particular case, we notice that he reveals himself as the King of Life. The King of Life. Chapter 12 It's most proper to kind of pick on that particular item because there are some verses, and many of the verses speak directly to this idea. If you follow along on your message guide, notice a couple verses. This is verses 12 and 13. It says, "The next day a great multitude that had come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him and cried out, 'Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel.'" Now you're going to notice this is the Palm Sunday, one of the traditional Palm Sunday texts. And you say, here we are, we're in March, and where are the palms? You know, some of you guys really like the palms. You like to be able to have a palm, and you like to be able to. And it was very interesting. I did Vi Swenson's memorial service, celebration of life service, and she loved Palm Sunday. And in her Bible were palms, that she portions of them that she used as bookmarks. Fear not, people. We will still have palms on Palm Sunday. But today, we're going to deal with Palm Sunday. Okay? So we're a little out of step, but we're not completely out of step. And so here we see this whole idea. And what do we see? Blessed is he who comes. He is the King of Israel. King of Israel. And so here in this particular chapter, the people recognize him as the king. As we continue, this is verses 14 and 15. Jesus, when he had found a young donkey, sat on it, as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold," what? "Your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." So it is that twice here he's referred to as the king. And so if you're familiar, you're going to see this particular chapter. There's three parts to this that I want us to just hit briefly today. Three parts to this chapter that expose, if you would, the kingship of Jesus and address this. These same three parts also speak to 3 days in the week, this last week of Jesus' earthly ministry and earthly life. So we've got three parts covering 3 days where Jesus is presented, and we deal with the issue of the kingship of Jesus, the one who is the King of Life. So let's unpack this together, all right? The first thing that we're going to see is this, is the recognition of the King. And this is verses 1 through verse 11 of chapter 12. It's the passage of Scripture that Penny read for us, and it deals with Jesus' time in Lazarus' house and the meal that he shares with them and Mary's act of worship as she anoints him with this precious oil. So we pick it up in verse 1, and again, we've looked at this, but let's go back to it. It says, "Then 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany." You know what? It's so cool when you read Scripture and it's like, wow, that's what our church is called. Our church is Bethany, you know? But he goes on, he says, "Where Lazarus was, who had been dead, whom he had raised from the dead, there they made him a supper, and Martha served, but Lazarus was one of those who sat at the table with him. Then Mary took a pound of very costly oil of spikenard, anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the fragrance of the oil." And so here we have, on the first day, this instance, this happening in the house of Lazarus. Jesus is back in Bethany. He's the guest of honor, if you would, at a dinner party. And some of these, some of the New Testament, the Gospels parallel this. In fact, all of the Gospels have this particular account in it. If you look over in Matthew chapter 26, this is what it reads. "Assuredly, I say to you, whoever this gospel is preached in the, wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman has done will also be told as a memorial to her." And so, as a part of this particular situation and this particular action on the part of Mary, from gospel to gospel, and indeed out through the ages, Mary is going to be remembered for this act of worship and recognizing the King. In the future, whenever this gospel is, Mary's going to be a part of the story. And there's a couple things to just note here. The first is the exampleship, and this is not part of your notes, but as I was working through these things again just in the last couple days, just write on the side, exampleship, exampleship. Mary provides an example for us of worship to the one who is the King. She provides an example for us of worship for the one who is the King. And it goes back to the chapter. She recognizes who Jesus is. And a little bit later in this first part of these verses, 1 to 11, we recognize that the religious leaders, they really didn't, these Jews did not recognize who Jesus was. And those that did, in perhaps didn't want him, they refused him, even when they were told and saw the miracles and the things that he had done. But Mary knew, and she acted on that, and she provides an example for us of someone who really was a worshiper. And here in the midst, she discovered and she announces who he is through her act of worship. The chief priests, the religious leaders, all of them with all of their knowledge, their familiarity with the scriptures, all of that they're studying, they all seeing his miracles, seeing his healing, seeing his teaching, they don't embrace him. They don't recognize him, if you would. And so what she does is she takes this precious oil. It's very costly, the scripture says, and she takes it and she opens this, and she begins to anoint the feet of Jesus as he is there at the meal. And, you know, as you might guess, or in hindsight, you say, boy, this completely makes sense, you know, from the perspective we're seeing it. Judas is there, one of the disciples, and we know Judas is the one who betrays Jesus and sells Jesus and, if you would, to the religious leaders, to the Jews for the 30 pieces of silver. He goes and he kind of gets on her case, if you would. And so what he says, but one of his disciples, Judas, Simon's son, who would betray him, said, why is this fragrant oil not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor? So he wants to know, why is it that she's using this precious ointment and this very costly ointment to anoint the feet of Jesus when they could just sell it and they could get this money and be able to take care of the poor? Now, we know in the scriptures that Judas was the one who kept the purse of the disciples. He was the treasurer of the organization. But Judas was I'll just use the vernacular here. Judas was as crooked as a dog's hind leg. I mean, he was just crooked. And so I'm going to venture to say that Judas is not offering and proposing the sale of this for the good of people who do not have food. I think Judas is probably putting it out there in order of the good of the money pouch and ultimately perhaps for himself. And so he says, why is this not happening? Why is, you know, it's worth this 300 denarii? And it's interesting to kind of unpack exactly what is being said here. How costly exactly is what this lady, what Mary is offering? And so at different places you see 300 denarii. If you have the old King James, I think it actually says 300 pence. Because King James was written largely for the British people, the English people, they used a monetary amount that they would be able to understand. And so I don't know if anybody here, and I'm not going to ask rhetorical, okay, but it may actually say, I think, 300 pence. But we know in Scripture that if you go over to Matthew chapter 20 to help kind of get a sense of this, the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. Now, when he had agreed with the laborers for a denarius a day, he sent them into his vineyard. So what does this tell us? It basically tells us that one of these is a day's wages. So what Judas is recognizing here is that when Mary brings this costly ointment and anoints the feet of Jesus and recognizing his kingship and who he is, she is offering to him and she is using what literally costs a year's wages. If you take 7 days a week, you've got a Sabbath, you back it out, you've got 1 day's wages in various, you got 300 of them. Basically, she cracked open a year's worth of value in order to put this on the feet of Jesus. Think about this. What an example she gives. It's amazing. So her example is recognizing Jesus. And the second E that I would want to kind of have you put on the side is her worship is extravagant. Extravagant. So she's an example in recognizing Jesus, but the kind of worship she offers is an extravagant worship. When is the last time, and I'm asking myself this, when is the last time I ever offered God something that was worth a year of my sweat and my endeavor and my labor? With one crack, she spent a year to worship the Lord and to recognize who he was. It was costly, expensive, it was extravagant. And here we understand that she does this in order you know, in order to be ready for his burial and for his death. And there's a sense in which her Jesus' disciples still hadn't figured this out. Jesus is still explaining the death and the crucifixion and why he's coming and what's going on and why he's going to Jerusalem and all of these things. He's still, later in this week, when they get to the upper room on that Thursday, he still has to explain it to them. I want to suggest to you that in recognizing the king, Mary understood and recognized something that the disciples themselves had not recognized yet. That she was offering something to him because of what she understood was going to happen, who he was, and what he was going to do. He's the king, and he's going to die. And so I'm going to give him my very best, extravagantly. And so there's a sense in which, there's this, and this is going to be the third word I'm going to suggest here, the third E, that there's an edification, that there's an edified, that there's a knowledge that she has that goes beyond that of the disciples and those that are following him. And it kind of brings us to her, to this transforming truth for today. And it's very simple. And it's just simply this: the best that we possess is not too good for Jesus. The best that we possess is not too good for Jesus. There's nothing that's too good for him. We offer him our very best, and ought to work in our lives to give him more and more of who we are and what we have, to give it over to his purposes and what he wants for us. And it's interesting, just as we close our look at these first couple verses, what does she do after she anoints and after Judas gets on her and stuff like that? It says that she takes her hair and she uses her hair to dry his feet. She uses her hair to wipe his feet. And that's pretty odd. You know, that is kind of odd. You know, why doesn't she just say, hey, can you bring me a towel? You know, I want to suggest to you that there's a kind of a picture that's created here, that Mary was willing to offer what she had, but Mary was also willing to offer herself. You see, there's a big difference between giving Jesus what we have and giving Jesus us. And Mary was willing to not only give Jesus what she had stored, maybe it was stored for her wedding day. It was part of her hope chest, part of her dowry, or part of just what she looked forward to in that day when she would have a husband herself. She gave Jesus what she had, but she also, in this image and in this picture, gives Jesus herself. And she takes her hair and she uses her very self to wipe his feet and to clean his feet. He is the King of life, and Mary recognizes the King. I wonder this morning, do you recognize the King? Do you know who Jesus is? Do you see Jesus for who he is? That he is the one we're gonna come to the table, we're gonna have communion later in the service, and we're gonna take that moment to remember his death, the shedding of his blood and the offering of his body on the cross. Do you recognize who Jesus is? Let me just say, Lent is a wonderful time for us to reflect and be reminded of who Jesus is. That he's not only the sovereign King, but he's the sacrificing King, giving himself for you and for me, loving us with his very life. Mary recognizes the King. Mary recognizes who Jesus is. Let me suggest, secondly, in John chapter 12, this particular thought, and that is the acclamation of the King. So here we have this instance, and this really takes us, if you would, to day two, and it's the original Palm Sunday. But it's when the people of the city of Jerusalem as he moves from Bethany to Jerusalem. It's when they recognize who Jesus is and they come out and they greet him and they wave the palms, and it's that traditional day, if you would. So he comes, basically it's 2 miles from Bethany to Jerusalem, and the city at this time, because of the Passover, is bursting with people, and many have heard about or have seen or been a part of or been in places where Jesus has had ministry. Jesus' ministry has been going on now for, basically 3 years, give or take. And so the acclaim and the renown of Jesus has spread. And so people, when they hear Jesus is coming and they know or have been a part of what's going on, they're looking to Jesus. And they want to be a part of what's going on. And so he approaches the city. He's coming from Bethany, approaching Jerusalem. The people have heard this, and we pick it up in verse 12 and 13. And these are the verses that we kind of use to focus on our theme for this morning. The next day, great multitude that had come to the feast of Passover, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of the palm trees, went out to meet him, and cried out, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." So those who are gathered there in the city, they come out and they take the palm branches off of the trees and they bring them and they use them to proclaim Jesus and to acknowledge Jesus. And in the middle of this drama unfolding, the religious leaders, the Jews, they're not happy. They're not happy about what's going on, because the people are lifting up Jesus, and the religious leaders have been trying to put him down. And they've been trying to marginalize Jesus, and they've been trying to catch him, and they've been trying to entrap him in the words and the things that he does and all of those things. And so the religious leaders, they get unhappy about what Jesus is doing. And, basically, here's this local guy, and he is causing all of this uproar and all of this trouble. And now what do we see? He's a national hero. Everybody's coming out to greet him like he's some kind of special guy. And they're upset about this. And in verse 18, we pick it up. This reason the people also met him, because they had heard about that he had done this sign, that being raising Lazarus. And so the Pharisees therefore said amongst themselves, "You see that you are accomplishing nothing. Look, the world has gone after him." And so it's important to understand what's going on here. The religious leaders, they're upset. The people are embracing Jesus. The palms are waving. The people are saying, "Hosanna. Jesus is the king. He's the king of Israel." And they're acclaiming that he is the king. They're proclaiming him the king. And the religious leaders, they're upset. And it's interesting. They begin, if you read this, they begin to fight amongst themselves about what's going on. They've been trying now for a while to catch Jesus and put him down. And they say, "What? You see that you're accomplishing nothing. You're trying this and, oh yeah, this and that." And they kind of squabble a little bit amongst themselves and are trying to, they come to the realization, if you would, that they've kind of lost grip on the situation. And Jesus is loose and people are coming to him. And so they're proclaiming him to be the king. And he does that by coming to Jerusalem, and there's a number of reasons why Jerusalem is important in this process of the king of life. We know from scripture that he's coming there to die, that the people of the Israelites, the Jews ethnically, those who he's been with, but then also the religious leaders, they've rejected him and are going to reject him. These are a fickle bunch of followers right now. And so while now they're acclaiming him the king and proclaiming him the king, in another couple days, they're going to be the ones who say, "Crucify him." So he's coming to Jerusalem to die. He's coming to fulfill the scriptures and the prophecies. And he's coming to show himself. And this is important too. Why this point? Why at this juncture? I think it's important to understand that as Jesus approaches the city and he comes to the city for Passover, that he's also proclaiming himself and showing himself to be the Passover lamb. That when they come together for Passover, they remember what happened in Egypt. They remember the lambs that were slain so that the blood could be put over the doorpost so that the death angel would pass over their homes. And they remember the meal, and they sit and they share in that meal, and the stories are told. And what's happening here is Jesus, as he comes to this place, is he is now creating the situation where the lambs are no longer needing to be slain, that Jesus himself is that once for all sacrifice, that he is the perfect lamb, the ultimate Passover lamb, so that all who are embrace him and his sacrifice do not need to worry about the judgment of God for sin on their lives, but can know forgiveness and know a restored relationship with him. And so in the midst of that, these people lift him up, and it brings us to what I'm going to call the third. So we've got the first day, he's with Lazarus and them. We've got the second day, and that is his entry into the city. And then we come to what I'm going to call the third day, and I'm going to call this the oration. Recognition, acclamation, and then we have the oration. Jesus basically here, if you would, to borrow a movie title, this is the king's speech. This is the king's speech. And he is going to now share his thoughts and his mind with regard to things. And this is verse 20 down through verse 50 through the end of the chapter. Notice, if you would, verse 20. Now there were certain Greeks among those who came up to worship at the feast. Then they came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida of Galilee, and asked him, saying, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." So this section unfolds by introducing some new people, the Greeks. If you would, these are Gentiles. These are not Jews. And we know historically that there were a number of Gentiles or Jews that were spiritual individuals. They were people who found worth and great depth, and they found something attractive in the Jewish faith. And so here we have these Greeks, these Gentiles, and they're coming, and they, I'm sure, also have heard about Jesus and what Jesus has done. And so they're there, and they want to see Jesus. So it says that they come to Philip, and they say, "Sir, we would see Jesus. We would see Jesus." There used to be, years ago, and this is just a complete aside, used to be years ago that many of the oldies, if you would, old pastors, years ago pastor, like gray hairs, like and gray hair and gone pastors, used to put on their pulpits the phrase, "Sir, we would see Jesus," so that when they were preaching, they were reminded of the calling of God on their life. And so here are these Gentile guys, and they're saying, "We want to see Jesus. Where is he? Can we get some moments with Jesus?" And so they come to Philip, and it's interesting, and we're not sure why they come to Philip. One of the things that we do know about Philip is that he is Greek, and so they think maybe it could be that he would be sympathetic to their request. His name is actually Philippos, which means a lover of horses. And Philip really is really not sure about this, and so the scripture tells us that he then goes, Philip, to Andrew, who was also connected with him and part of that original group that came to Jesus that we saw back in the beginning of the book of John. Andrew himself also Jewish or Greek, and they're not sure what to do about these Greeks seeing Jesus and having time with Jesus, and they're not sure how to unpack this. And there is some ambiguity in the ministry of Jesus, whether or not he embraced the Jews or the Gentiles. When Jesus sent out those followers of him on a mission trip, do you remember this? Prior to the feeding of the 5,000, he sends out the disciples, and he sends them out, to do what? To share the good news with Jews. And he specifically kind of says, this is for the Jews, it's not for the Gentiles. So they're kind of unsure what to do about this here. But what I think is happening here is that Jesus' ministry has reached a point where knowing that the gospel, the good news, is for all people, go into all the world, make disciples of all nations, all peoples, all right? that, you know, that whether you were Jew or Greek, there is this desire and there is this now opening of a door for the embracing of the gospel and the sharing of the gospel with people who are not just simply Jewish. And so we see this first interaction here, and it leads us to his final speech. And so notice the parts of this, and we'll only share parts of it to kind of give it a skeleton. I'll trust that you'll go back this week and kind of unpack the rest of chapter 12. But the first thing we see here is that Jesus shares about an imminent cross. And he speaks about death, he speaks about denial, and he speaks about, and it's interesting as you unpack these verses here, he's going to be talking about two lives in these verses. He talks about a spiritual life, a heavenly life. He talks about an earthly life. And he's talking about those and offers an invitation to those who are there to follow and to serve him, and that Jesus will be with them and will honor them for their service. That he talks about this imminent cross. This is verse 32 and 33. And I, if I am lifted up from the earth, speaking of the cross, will draw all people to myself. This he said to signify by what death he would die. So he talks about the cross and he presents that out there. And it's interesting to notice the word draw. I was thinking about this week. We are drawn to Jesus because of who Jesus is. We're not driven. Do you know what I'm saying? Like sometimes our experiences in life drive us to seek something different. But Jesus himself never drives us. It's who Jesus is and what he has done and how he loves us that draws us to him, like a light draws the moth, you know, kind of thing. And so it struck me this week about, you know, that Jesus is not driving people to himself. He's drawing people. Those of you who are here this morning, you know, we're drawn to Jesus because of how he changes our lives and how he touches us and how the transforming power of what he does in our lives. And so we see the cross is coming. He's going to be lifted up. He's going to draw people to himself. He's doing this and he's sharing this so that they would understand what kind of death he would suffer. And then notice he identifies the immense pain that he's going to be in. This is verse 27. Now my soul is troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose, I came to this hour. We don't often think about Jesus being troubled. We often think about Jesus as the Son of God. Jesus got it all together. Jesus never makes a mistake. He's perfect. We know from Scripture that he was tested. He's tried in all ways like us, but he never sinned. But the Scripture makes it clear that Jesus is troubled. That this is not an easy experience for him. It's a painful experience. It's going to be physically painful. It's painful in terms of emotionally painful. There's a sense in which other words that have been used to describe this word troubled, my soul is distressed. Scripture talks about Jesus trembling. But yet Jesus is willing to go through all of the horrors that he will go through during this week, the carrying of the cross and the whipping and the berating and the all of the things that are a part of the trial and those types of things. And he does this, he faces this horror in order to accomplish the purposes of God and to give his life for us. So we have the cross that is coming, and he recognizes the pain that is going to be his, and he recognizes what I'm going to call the impending darkness. We know that as part of the experience on the cross that it goes dark. And that there is a period of time that theologians struggle to work through, where Jesus, in a way that is hard to put to words, is separated as he takes the sin of the world upon himself. He is separated from his Father. And for the first time in all eternity, there's that connection is not there. In verse 35, it says this: "Then Jesus said to them, 'A little while longer, the light is with you. Walk while you have light, lest darkness overtake you. He who walks in darkness does not know where he is going.'" And he unpacks this whole situation here of darkness and light, that the light, I'm the light, I'm not going to be with you all the time. In fact, there's this coming darkness. If you go back to John chapter 1, where we started weeks ago, Jesus is presented as what? He's presented as light. He's presented as light. There's this darkness, this is coming. But then I'm going to share, fourthly, the sense that there is this important response to this situation. The response to Jesus, our response to Jesus, is important. And you can't be exposed to him or the truth about Jesus without making an important choice. That the question, what are you going to do with Jesus? What are you going to do with this king? And so he goes in verse 42 and 43. "Nevertheless, even among the rulers, many believed, but because of the Pharisees, they didn't confess him. They kept it quiet, lest they should be put out of the synagogue, for they loved the praise of men more than the praise of God." And so there's a response. So if some of these religious leaders, they respond and they embrace Jesus, but they want to keep it quiet because of the implications of all of those things. So let me just close our time together today. We've got 3 points, John chapter 12. We've got the recognition of the king by Mary, and this offering, this sacrifice of what she has, but also herself. We have this acclamation. We have the people coming to Jesus because they've heard and they've embraced him. But these are fickle followers and the religious leaders. It kind of sets them off against each other, and they're trying to figure out what's going on because, you know, they haven't been able to dissuade the people, at least to this point. And then finally, we have this word, this sharing of Jesus' heart, this oration, if you would, this speech that Jesus shares. And he says, you know, that this cross, I'm going to the cross, it's imminent, and there's going to be pain, it's going to be immense. And so we look, and there's coming a time, and people are making this choice with what are they going to do with me, and whether they will open themselves up to the king, embrace the king, or they will refuse him, and they will walk away from him. And so just 3 closing thoughts today that I want to leave with you. They're very quick. The first is this, that we notice here that salvation is not limited to specific types of people. We notice here that Jesus and people, men and women, embrace Jesus. We've got Mary, and we've got Lazarus, and we've got those there. We've got religious leaders, and we've got the simple people. We've got the disciples, and we have those that are joining them. All different kinds of people are embracing Jesus. And our salvation and the salvation that Jesus offers, is not limited to just a certain type of people. And so it's important to understand when we share the message and when we share our light, you know, we can't sit there and say, well, that person, this, we don't know. And so we share the message with the people that God puts in the course of our life, because this good news is available. Jesus, I think, would say for the Jew and the Gentile, for all of the people, and it's not just limited to specific types of people. We secondly see that worship is not locked to special types of people. That anybody can worship. Mary worshiped at a dinner table, and the crowds are worshiping in the street, and the Greeks come and they want to worship Jesus, and they are there and they hear the message that Jesus shares, and actually. Hold on. Cross that out. Does yours say times? Yes. All right, good. My mistake. Sometimes we think, and I'm like, wait, why does this not sound right? Sometimes we think that our worship is only limited to 10 o'clock on Sunday morning. But we can worship at our dinner table, we can worship in our homes, we can worship at work, we can worship in the car when we're driving to work or we're driving home. We're in the midst of traffic and we're like flustered. Yeah, that's a great time to worship, okay? It'll keep you from road rage, you know? And sometimes worship is just best when it's spontaneous, when it just happens and the Lord speaks to your heart and you're like, wow, that's awesome. And we worship at that point. So it's not limited to specific people. It's not locked into a certain time. And we also see that faith is not lived on selfish terms. Our faith isn't lived out on selfish terms. And then that really is kind of a paradox because our faith is personal, but our faith is lived out to other people. We have these paradoxical things that, when we are humbled, we're lifted up, and when we give, we're able to keep, and he replaces those things. When those who are great should serve, and those who are served are the great, and when we die to ourselves, we actually live, and there are these kinds. You're like, wow, I don't. But one of the things that we do see is that our faith isn't lived on selfish terms. It's lived through extravagant worship and giving and through embracing who Jesus is, like Mary and like the disciples ultimately do as we follow their experience. So John chapter 12 today, as we work our way through the Lenten chapters of John, and we start by seeing that Jesus is the King and he's lifted up as the King. It's Palm Sunday. And so the first 3 days of our Lenten experience. So what will we do with this? Well, first, let me encourage you to open your hearts to the Lord and to embrace him. Don't be one of those individuals that refuses him. Secondly, let me encourage you to offer your very best to him because he's worthy of our very best. He deserves our very best. And finally, let me just say that as we enter these weeks, as we head up to Easter, that we need to be open to who we would share with and how the Lord would move on our heart and on our life, and that we would not see our faith as our own, but that we would be willing to share our faith with others as he provides the opportunity. One of the things that's so upfront in this particular passage of Scripture is the issue of Jesus offering himself and the imminence of the cross. And on a monthly basis, we come together and we share in a time that we call communion. It reflects on the upper room, on that Passover experience, where Jesus is with the disciples and he shares with them. He brings them to a place of understanding a little bit better what it is that's going to transpire in the next days for them and for him. And we know that ultimately it ends up on Good Friday with the cross and Jesus' blood being shed and his body there being offered on the cross for you, for me. We call it the Lord's table. We call it communion. We remember the preciousness of that gift when we come together the first Sunday with symbols. And on your way in this morning, I trust that you received a little prepackaged wafer and some juice. And the symbols that are in this little container remind us of his body that was hung on the cross, was broken for us, his blood that was shed for us. It reminds us of the sacrifice of his life, that as Paul says in Romans chapter 8, that while we were still sinners, God commanded his love toward us, that he offered his son, his one and only son, in our place. And so we come together and we take a moment to reflect on, and I guess it's particularly meaningful, particularly as we come to the Lenten season, to just think about what Christ did as we head towards those specific times of doing that. So let me ask you to just carefully peel back the see-through kind of film, if you would, and expose the wafer that is there. Now, the wafer is a reminder of us of Christ's body and the offering of his body for us. And Paul shares with regard to that in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And he says, I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. So when we come together and when we share, when we eat this small wafer, we're reminded that Christ offered his body for us, that he took our place and accepted the wages of sin, which Scripture says is death. And he did it for you and for me. So let's give thanks to the Lord. Let's just pray, and then we'll share in the wafer together. Father, we thank you so much as we head through this wonderful, Lord, serious, this season that calls for reflection and remembering. And so today we remember once again what you did for us on the cross, which we will come to in a few weeks. We are reminded that your body, as the bread was broken that night, your body broken for us. And so in the taking of this symbol, we are reminded and we remember and we give thanks. And we pray and we ask that you might help us to just reflect on the pain that was yours, but Lord, also the great prize that is ours in Jesus. We ask it in his name. Amen. Let's share in the wafer together. Let me also ask you now to peel back the other section of the cup, and the juice is there. Also in the upper room, as Jesus shared with the disciples, Scripture reminds us that after supper, he took a cup, and they shared in a cup together that Jesus used to create a symbol, to create a picture for us to carry forward. And Paul shares about it in the same passage from 1 Corinthians 11. It says, in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat the bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And so Jesus shares the bread with them, and then he shares the cup with them. And the cup, a symbol of his blood that would be shed. It's a reminder from Hebrews that without the shedding of blood, there cannot be any forgiveness. And so Jesus offers up himself, his body, his blood in our place. And he creates from the cup at that meal a symbol that we reflect on and we remember even these centuries later. And so let's pray together and give thanks for the cup. Father, we thank you for this cup that we hold, for the symbolism of it, for the reminder of the love of Christ, who, not willing to sidestep the pain, was willing to endure the pain on our behalf. Lord, we thank you for the gift of Jesus and the great prize of salvation that is ours because of his great love. As we share in these elements today, help us to remember that you truly are the King, that you are sovereign over all, and even in that, Lord, you are willing to sacrifice, you are a sacrificing King, willing to even give your own life for us, your children. And so we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's share in the cup together. This morning, as we've shared in song, we started with Crown Him with Many Crowns, which was just a reflection and a reminder that he is the King. And we give those crowns, our crowns, and every crown that can be worn, we give to him. And that one, we come to worship. Come, now is the time to worship. We worship that crowned one, and that one is also the one who is mighty to save. It's transforming for our lives. And so may it be that transformation and that work continues in our life, that the King continues to change us and to lift us up. And so we're going to close this morning with the song, I Will Rise. The song is going to be our closing. And so following the song, you're going to be dismissed. We hope that you'll stay for a cup of coffee. And if interested, you can come and sit in on the deacon's class, the sermon discussion group, or just enjoy fellowship. We're so glad that each of you is here this morning. And we pray your blessing upon we pray the Lord's blessing upon you and the week that's ahead. Let's close our service this morning in song.
So please rise as we sing, I Will Rise. There's a peace I've come.